Okay, welcome. This is 1260. We're going to be talking about the posterior back view today. And one of the things that's unique about the back point of view is that most of us are really familiar, even young children are familiar with the front view. And young children can really do a fantastic job of drawing that. So they can also critique your drawings if it's right or wrong. So that's kind of a fun thing. But the back view has less landmarks, and so it is more challenging. So you have to be really careful that you're aware of those landmarks and proportions, or you'll get drift. So here is our drawing of the proportions, and we have the front and back view on this. Right here is the back of the head. If you can't see this, I encourage you to get to a point where you can. So here's your head length, and it ends at the base of the neck, where you would see that. And then you get a head length between that decision and the base of the scapula. And we talked about the scapula before. Let's bring out our skeleton here and just remind everyone of this decision. Okay, so here we have the scapula. And here it, remember, as far as proportion, it's about one hand length. Okay, so it's not a head length, which is here to here, it's a hand length. And it has some unique features to it. So it has a trough here that's a muscle called the sacrospinalis, the supraspinatus, sits in this trough. So a lot of what you're seeing on the accrochet, you think that this is a really deep muscle on the trapezius, and it is deeper, but it is not all that you're seeing right here. This trapezius right here, it has embedded in it a deeper muscle that is the supraspinatus. So you've got this spine and this medial border of the scapula. That's really important because this medial border helps you as an alignment on your rhomboid. And most often you can see either the medial side or the spinous process, but a lot of times not both at the same time. So here's our arm. And when this arm, this skeleton won't allow us to do this, but when it goes above 90 degrees, so this is above 90 degrees, the scapula shifts and moves out. So it's no longer a vertical here. And I think that's an important notation. So on the back view, we have the spine. This is the spinal column. This is the first, or atlas, that the skull sits on. We have some very, very important neck muscles that help us to move that neck and hold it up. And we'll be discussing the neck all in one separate unit. So we've got, these are all numbered, they're called the cervical vertebrae, and it ends right here in the seventh. Now this seventh one, that's the important landmark. So if you reach back and feel that bump on your neck, the base of your skull, right here, that's where your seventh cervical is. Important landmark, okay? So you've got your overall shoulder line, okay? And you're gonna sight that. And you also know where the AC process is. So you can see that plane break of the AC process on the posterior point of view as well. So you've got this alignment, you've got the spinal column itself. Now, from the seventh cervical down, there are 12 vertebrae, and they are numbered just like the cervical are. So there are 12 of those, and it goes T1, 2, 3, etc. And it ends right here. Well, we know that the 10th rib is the landmark for us, right? So in the front. But oftentimes, especially on the female figure, you'll just see a nub right here. So you can use whatever you see as the base of that for that particular model. Next, on the spinal column, you have 5 of the lumbar. And one thing that's really important about this spine, and I've kind of shown it here on this drawing, is that the spine has a short. Okay, so it does a short right here on the cervical. And then it wraps around in a long. And then it has a plane break right here. And then it gets another direction change right here in the lumbar that's short. And that's known in drawing as the S curve. Very important drawing construct. So that short, long, short, that rhythm is an S. And you see that throughout the human body. Now, on this particular drawing in profile, you can see these aspects. So you've got, here's your shoulder line. Rotate you just a bit so you can see this. So you've got your shoulder line here. You've got your overall short, long, short, ending in the top of the head of the sacrum. And that's this triangular form right here. And some areas that we're going to watch for is this is the high point on the back of the pelvic structure. So you see these dimplings here on the pelvic structure, more so on the female than on the male. But this looks like a little butterfly-like shape or a butterfly wing, okay? So you've got the landmark of where this scapula ends. You've got the spinous process. You still want to envision where this starts. Where's the head of that thoracic chamber? And this is something that we focused in on all week for both my 1260 class and my 2260. And this is one of the areas that I see most common that is something that needs to be strengthened on the drawings. And that's that misunderstanding of perspective. So what I'm talking about, and you can see this is a drawing by Stephen Assell, and it's a point of view that's the front, but I couldn't find one of the back. So here he shows his students to draw a small cubed out and rectangle of the actual position that they're seeing in. So I think that's really important to be able to do that so that you have that information. So just, lightly, from your point of view, draw a rectangle and get the right perspective. For your point of view, this would be the model would be sitting on the model stand. And make sure that you get this rotation. So if this is the case, this would be how much you'd see to midline, then this, then the side plane. So what I'm seeing is, as students are drawing, they're envisioning this proportion or shape, and then they tend to subdivide it, which is not correct, okay? Make sure you see the proportion from midline, to the side plane. And then first and foremost, see this as a shape, because it is a shape. The overall back is a shape. So from here, the shoulder line to the AC process, and then you're siding in your midline, that creates this trapezoid-like shape. It's really important as far as hierarchy of drawing to create shape. And so that's one of the ways that we get measurements of length and shape. All right, now the actual anatomy for the back. So talked about some of the skeletal structure. I want to be able to see the plane changes as we draw. From RT today, this is our model. I haven't had the opportunity to work with RT before, but I'm looking forward to it. So here is the planar man. And this is the top plane. So as you can see from the overhead lighting, this is a light facing plane. And then the next thing you're gonna get is this plane is inverted in. Now the reason I'm pointing that out right now is I want you to look with me at this particular muscle. So this muscle sits underneath this form of the trapezius. So it's a deeper muscle. It's called a rhomboid. So a rhomboid-like shape does this. So that's where it gets its name for this plane. And it's two chevron or rhomboid shapes that do this. So on this planar man, you can see that this isn't horizontal across this form. That right here next to the spinal column, this dives in to the spinal column on both sides. Well, the muscle that's responsible for that is the rhomboid. And it's a deep tissue muscle. And it sits right underneath the trapezius. It's doing this. So independently, you won't see the rhomboid. I can't think of an instance where you would go, oh, that, you know, on the surface, that's the rhomboid. But you have to be aware that it's there. It's sitting right here underneath, and it's creating this V-like structure right here and here on that thoracic chamber. Okay, so we have these deep layer muscles, and we're aware of those deep layer muscles, but most of what we study in anatomy are the muscles that actually are evident on the outer edge of the form. And one of these muscles is called the trapezius. And I love this muscle. It has it all. It has front, back, and side. So here we have the nuchal ligament. If you can reach up in your neck, this is the cord where this starts, and this is the base of the skull. So the base of the skull is right here. This is the mastoid process, and this little bump, you can feel it on your own skull, that's the occiput. I just think those are the fun names in anatomy. Occiput. Okay, so it's like, this is why this is important. If you wanted to drive to the Capitol building, downtown Salt Lake, could you head southbound and get to that destination? Not unless you're in Bountiful. You probably couldn't, okay? So if you're coming from Sandy and you want to get to the Capitol building, you have to know where you're beginning and where your destination is, correct? Well, the same thing with a muscle. We need to know where that starts out and where it ends. And so this trapezius muscle, it starts right here, the back of the nuchal ligament, it's over this. And the important thing for you, and you can see it well on this planar man, more so on this écorché, is you can see that this shape takes the shape of a kite. And hopefully you can see that, yeah. Okay, so this is the shape. So it dives here. And it creates this outer contour line that you can see on the anterior of the form, and you can see on the posterior of the form. So it dives to the AC process. It runs along. along this spinous process right here, then it trajects down, meaning it changes direction. It dives and creates this big long cord in here, and it ends right here on T12, right at the base. So one of you had asked me about the trapezius, and so I drew this out for you. It's a lot easier to understand that way. That's the shape. One time when my husband and I went to Italy in 2000, and we saw men and women were wearing their sweater like a cape over and tying it here in front. And it was just a style. I don't know if you've seen that before. I came home and started wearing my sweater like that. And my daughter was a teenager at that time. She's like, no, 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 Mom, we won't be doing that. But I thought it was rather cool, you know, because it was from Italy. But that reminded me of how the trapezius, Sam.
I was just wondering, do you want me to help you with the camera so that it's always pretty seen?
Oh, it's good.
Okay, all right.
Thank you for offering, that's very kind. So that trapezius has a long range that it sits on the back. It's a major back muscle. Now underneath that is a muscle that starts up here and goes clear down to the sacrum. And it is this big shape like this. And you can see it right here on your plaster cast. So it's this cord that runs straight up on either side of the spinal column. And that's it's called the erector spinae. Oh, I didn't write that down. Okay, so it's either referred to in your anatomy book as the sacrus spinalis or the erector spinae, either one. Does the same thing, it holds you erect. Now remember that as we discuss muscles, muscles only do one thing. They do not push, they only pull. Okay, muscles only pull. So, in thinking about this, you've got this long corded muscle that runs clear down the back. What does that mean as far as muscles? What does that tell you? If muscles work in opposition for each other and they team tag, what does that say about muscles? If we have this big long cord coming down the back, what would we have on the front? Remember, they work in opposition, Sam?
Abdominals.
Oh, right, absolutely. So if you have one muscle moving in the back, you have a corresponding mover in the front because they work in opposition. They're either at rest, they're active, or they're inactive. So muscles can't be all three all at once. Except for the great master Michelangelo, who drew everything all at once in action. And that's why it looks like the figures of Michelangelo have a lot more going on, a lot more muscles. It's because he has all the muscles working. But in nature, that doesn't really work. So what does that tell you about his drawings? Any thoughts?
Use the model that was straining.
Okay. He was so competent, such a master at understanding muscles, that he didn't have to draw from a model, and most of the times they did some of that, but up until the time of the Renaissance, they weren't allowed to, because of the predominant religion in the area, they weren't allowed to actually use a model. And so the Medici family had gathered a whole bunch of Greek sculpture and had brought them into their garden and allowed some of the great masters of the day. I would, you know, someday if we could teleport or something, that's where I'd like to go, to that garden on that day and see Donatello and Botticelli and Brunelleschi and Michelangelo and Raphael and Leonardo da Vinci, and they were all alive and drawing in one drawing session in that garden. Wouldn't that have been awesome? So they had a lot going on as far as catching up, and what they ended up doing is they ended up studying from these casts that came from the Greek period. Well, this is a lot of what we're doing, is we're understanding from the cast and then working from the model. Okay, moving on. The next muscle we've got, I mentioned the rhomboids, so we've talked about the trapezius, the sacrospinalis, and now we're gonna talk about the serratus. Now the serratus are deep tissue muscles, but they do have an access point that we see and we've covered. Okay, so right there, this is the external oblique. Right there is the serratus. And I remind you that you could see about four of them, and they're fingers. So those fingers come down and they do this. They interdigitate. So they act like plywood where they stack and link, and that's to create strength. So they come across the lateral side of the form. You can't see it on the planes of the head, but you can see a portion on the back view, and they're not really good landmarks. You can slightly see a little bit of cast shadow sometimes. Not always, it depends on how the model is lit. So that's sitting underneath your latissimus and just has right up here, you might see a slight bulge on that serratus. And remember, to the Greeks, the serratus meant a knife that was serrated. So that's where the name came from, is serratus. Okay, the next muscle group that we're going to talk about is the infraspinatus. So this is one you're going to see on the model, especially if their arms are out. You have this group that's almost like a deltoid. And, you know, again, we see in shapes, this muscle group looks like this in here. And it sits underneath the plane break on the deltoid. So it's beginning right here. Here's the back axis of the deltoid muscle. Now this is a shoulder muscle, but you see it right here. It has a point of insertion right here on your spinous process. Origin, not insertion. So it has access, the deltoid has access here where it originates, side plane, and then your back is along. If you were sculpting this, you would pack that right into that spinous process right there. So then you get this form right in here. And that's the form that I'm talking about. So you would see this three group of muscles. You would see the infraspinatus, you would see the teres minor, and the teres major. Now, most often you do not see the teres minor and major as separate muscles. They really kind of tend to blend together, but that whole group does. And so it's very rare that you would see a lot of definition in that. I'm sure there's cases that you could. This is a very important little triangle right here. There's a plane break in between muscle, between the trapezius, the latissimus, and this group of muscles, the infraspinatus, teres minor, and major. And right here, there's nothing. Who knows why this blank little triangle is so important? It's a medical question. Anyone know? Okay, when a doctor takes his stethoscope and listens to you, he's listening right there because he has the closest access on the back point of view to listening to your heart and lungs, right from that little triangle. So for doctors, that's really important. Okay, I just think these are points of interest. All right, so now, using another analogy, if you were to put a towel around your waist, then you get the latissimus dorsi. Well, first, I'm going to show you what it does on the plaster cast. This is really cool. And I hope I can show it here. Okay, so right there, this is where that latissimus is coming up underneath. What's it connecting to? What's the point of origin? Anybody tell on the skeleton? It's the humerus. Okay, so it originates right on the back of the occipital, the bicipital plane on the humerus. Why? Why would we need a back muscle on our arm, for heaven's sakes? Anyone? Yeah. So that muscle, and remember, I've showed you this in your book. What?
That also where the funny bone is. Never mind, it's a stupid joke.
No, it's not stupid. I just, it's harder with a mask to understand. Okay, so in your book, and I study this all the time, I think this is a fascinating part, and it has these fantastic little images that you can draw in a sketchbook. So I just love those. There, if you read them, they're just chock full of information. Okay, so basic, simple information. And on pages 110 and 111 in your book, it shows the muscles that we're talking about. And it gives you the point of origin, the point of insertion, and the action. So when we look at the latissimus dorsi here, Paula, you said what it did. It attaches to the arm for drawing the arm forward. Okay, so when we're doing a stroke like this of any sport, you're using your latissimus dorsi. How about this one, the butterfly? That is rotating your arms forward, and that's using your latissimus. So knowing what a muscle is capable of moving is another important concept of why we learn the muscles. And you know, I just expect that as you're going through the course of this, you become very familiar with the muscles. So what I like to do myself is when I'm drawing from the model, I review what I'm seeing. And that's a really good way to start training yourself to see the muscles. All right, so this is the latissimus. It runs along underneath the trapezius. It has an origin on your spinal column. And then it inserts. We talked about the PSIS. It actually inserts higher on the high point of the pelvic structure. So we have the external oblique from the front to the side to the back. And we have this big cord, and sometimes it can have two tendons, that the latissimus inserts right here on the top of the pelvis. All right, next. Let's see, I've covered that one. Just make sure I'm reviewing all of this. Okay, so one of the things that is important also on this is that this medial side, especially in a female, you'll look down and you'll get the alignment right here of the outer convexity of the pelvic structure. Okay, so that sight down from that medial side. Always sight your back point of view. Always sight the back of the body and bottom of the gluteal fold. So this is the gluteal fold right here. Okay? This is the gluteal cleft. I know there's common names, but that's what we'll call it here in class. So here's the top of that cleft, meaning that it's the bottom of the sacrum. So that's an important one to know as well. We cover that. This is a clear indication of that form right here on the infraspinatus, teres minor and major. And I wanted to point out this drawing. This summer I had mentioned that I'd studied from this incredible artist. It's a husband-wife team. Her name is Amaya, and I'm not even going to be able to say her last name. How would you say this? G-U-R-P-I-D-E.
Wait. G
is in good. Mm-hmm. U-R-P-I-D-E. I noticed her husband couldn't say her last name either. I thought that was funny.
Wait.
Ironic. It's Irvine. A very, what?
Irvine.
She said it a little different than that.
Probably not pronounced how it's spelled.
It's not?
Probably not.
Okay. Anyway, this is Amaya's work. And this is a drawing that she did with multimedia. And it's called Galerna. And I think it's exquisite. So that's all done in graphite and charcoal and highlighted with white. And this is just a print, but you can see that. I'm pointing it out because I'd love you to look it up. You could follow her on Instagram. But this is just an exquisite composition. What you're seeing here is she draped a mannequin. So in the drawing, you can see the head of that mannequin in front of the model. One thing that she did that I thought was really fascinating is, and I had a student yesterday that had some of it, but I had particularly never used it before, and she had black tape, and when she was composing, what she would crop out of this drawing, she used black tape, artist tape, to do that composition. I thought that was really fascinating. So, those are the major muscles of the back. That's how we see it. We see in shape. We use comparative measurement to get our, to cite our angles, to get our lengths, to get our proportions. We're thinking about the rectangle and the square. And so, to the side of your drawing today, before you even begin, indicate the perspective of that view from your, where you're standing at your easel. Okay, any questions?
Not for now.
Okay, thank you.